Good evening, distinguished panelists, members of the Chennai International Center, honored guests. This is an unusual event, the seventh program of the Chennai International Center, where spirituality meets the more mundane world. Pointing to the eclectic nature of the Chennai International Center's programs. With us here are three very distinguished panelists whose ideas should set us thinking on unusual lines. We have on the extreme left the Venerable Samdong Rinpoche, philosopher, one of the world's leading scholars on Tibetan Buddhism, who completed his initiation and was ordained as a monk in Tibet and then moved to India. He has distinguished himself in the religious sphere with his erudition, deep spiritual practices and teaching, and has contributed to the preservation of Tibetan cultural heritage. In academia, he has served as the director of the Central Institute of Higher Tibetan Studies in Sarnath that he built up, and was even the chairman of the Association of Indian Universities. In politics, as a very reluctant entrant, he was elected overwhelmingly as the Prime Minister of the Tibetan government in exile. The book of his conversation, with the title Uncompromising Truth for the Compromised World, from which the title of this discussion is adapted, is an authoritative exposition of Tibetan Buddhist thought combined with the ideas of Mahatma Gandhi and Jai Krishnamurti. Then in the middle, you have the Venerable Tenzin Priyadarshi, who is a philosopher, educator, and innovative thinker. He was born in Bihar and entered the Buddhist order at an early age. In addition to his religious training and studies at the Central Institute in Sarnath, he also received his undergraduate education in physics in the United States and his master's degree in the comparative philosophy of religion from Harvard University. He is now at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he is the founding director of the Dalai Lama Center for Ethics and Transformative Values and is the director of the Ethics Initiative at MIT Lab, that has introduced several innovative programs at the Sloan School of Management at MIT. He has lectured widely on Tibetan Buddhist thought around the world. In addition to contributing as a panelist today, he will be moderating the discussion. He and the Venerable Samdong Rinpoche are in Chennai to guide a retreat organized by the Maitreem Poshes Trust. The trust started under the guidance of the Venerable Samdong Rinpoche with Mrs. Prema Srinivasana as the moving spirit, seeks to encourage scholarship and teaching in Buddhist studies and provide sustainable livelihoods to the marginalized. With these two distinguished men of the cloth, we have another deeply spiritual person in Mr. Gurumurthy. He needs no introduction to a Chennai audience, but I shall nevertheless do that for the sake of balance. Chartered accountant by profession, writer and commentator on political and economic issues by choice, is how he describes himself on his Twitter page. This grossly understates his enormous contribution to the public policy discourse and to the shaping of public policy in many areas. We all know him as a crusader against corruption, bold and forthright in his views, uncompromising in his pursuit of the truth, not hesitating to take on the highest in the land. He is the ideologue of the Swadeshi Jagran Manch, promoter of Indian thinking on the economy, and an admirer of homegrown entrepreneurship in the small and medium sectors. He is, of course, well known as a standard bearer of Hindutva. The theme of today's discussion comprises three interlinked ideas. The first, starting from the end, is the compromised world. We would like to hear the views of the panelists on how they view the state of the world now. The second is the notion of ethics and what it comprises. We have the widely recognized spiritual values of dharma, non-violence, compassion, truth, austerity, sacrifice, and so on. In political philosophy, we have the notions of justice, virtue, equality, concern for the least advantage, the categorical imperative, and so on. And we have the economic ideas of equality, welfare, poverty elimination, and the driving forces of self-interest, the work ethic, and the tendency to accumulate. When all these values and interests intersect in daily life, where do spiritual or ethical values stand? The third part of the title is Uncompromising Ethics. How uncompromising should the ethics be? Is there any room at all for negotiation and for compromise? These and other questions will be addressed by the panelists in what promises to be a fascinating interaction. In fact, this seventh event of the CIC today will be followed by a discussion tomorrow with Sadhguru at Grand Chola. That will be the eighth event. So I'll now leave the proceedings to the Venerable Tenzin Priyadarshi to take it forward.
Good evening, and thank you very much for the kind and generous introduction to the panelists and to the topic this evening. I think perhaps what we will do is give both the presenters about 10 minutes, and I mean 10 minutes, to do some opening remarks, and then perhaps that would lead us into some sort of discussion and conversation. And then at some point, we'll include the audience to perhaps participate in it. I know most of you are sort of, the thing that on your mind right now is the ethical implications of demonetization. And it's generally normal that the things that are most urgent to us, that becomes the primary concern of the conversation. But that's just one of the implications. So we will have an opportunity to perhaps discuss it or at least get some opinions. But we want to go, or the objective of this conversation is to perhaps go slightly deeper into the whole idea of where we are as a society, as a world. And is there a room for ethics? What should it be? What would the world look like without it? Those are some of the considerations with which we wish to begin. So maybe I'll request the user to begin with some opening remarks.
I feel upgraded to be part of such an evolved and venerable souls by my side. It is as difficult to get an audience like this as it is difficult to be part of a podium like this. You know, the idea of ethics is perceived as an individual virtue. It is an individual virtue, and on that there can be no doubt. But I would also see that it is not exclusively an individual virtue. There is a huge role for the society, for the family, for the general ecosystem. But unfortunately, in focusing on the individual, we have more focused on individualism. Individualism has cut at the root of a person's relationship with the not only fellow human, but also with nature. You know, it's a huge topic, that ethics we tend to limit it only to human behavior. But it is human behavior in various situations. There is ethical warfare and unethical warfare. And if you look at how warfare had been designed in this country, at least, it's one of the noblest war models. And it was not legislated. Anything that is legislated can never be ethical, because ethics can never be legislated. Unfortunately, we tend to mix law and ethics. Ethics can produce a better law, but law cannot produce ethics. But unfortunately, we live in a world which we call modern, where we are governed by personal contracts in respect of human relationship inter se, and social contract in the context of the state. Unless we analyze how these two elements have worked in the last couple of hundred years, and what kind of damage it has caused to the very foundation of ethics, we will not be able to zero in on whether there is a possibility of an ethical world. I mean, so much of information is available today. I'll just quote one or two. See, there was a professor by name R.J. Rammel. He built a huge website called DemoSide over 30 years. He was a Hawaii University professor, and he completely comprehensively put together the data on how human beings have killed human beings in the last 2500 years. And he found that there is only one geography in which this did not happen on a mass scale, and that was India. Between 5th century BC to the completion of the 20th century, he found that 1.2 billion people have been killed in internecine warfare of all kinds of violence. But he notified, he zeroed in on only 3 cases of mass violence till the 13th century in India. One is the Kalinga War, next is the killings by thuggies, and the third is the killings by sati. He said in this sati and thagi, the killings were in tens of thousands, not even in hundreds of thousands. There must be something inherent in this whole ecosystem which functioned in the society till the 13th century, much of which is prevalent even today, according to me, that has kept us going as a peaceful society. What is it? Because our education system, our public discourse, our media putting together the news and views do not seem to get us anywhere near the self-examination. Why? After 13th century, many of you know that invasions have caused huge amount of death, variously estimated at 85 million people having died in these killings by invaders. But the point I am trying to make is that to reduce ethics or ethical behavior to merely an individual virtue, and to rely on only a spiritually grown individual to be ethical, is not only to limit the idea of ethics, but to rule out the role of the society in that. The society itself is a spiritual institution. A family is a spiritual institution. So, in our idea of individualism, we have alienated the individuals from what are the real sources of ethics. And unless we examine this, how a stateless society could function in India, a society could defy even a hostile state and still preserve a very large body of our behavioral model. And I will close with the present situation. In fact, when I was addressing a meeting in UCLA, I asked the audience, how many villages and towns we have and how many police stations we have in this country? We had at that time in 2001 when I was talking, it was about 7 lakh villages and towns, and we had only 12,400 police stations at that time. Now the villages and towns have come down in number because villages have become towns. 6.7 lakh villages and towns, we have only 12,800 police stations. Still, you go to nationmaster.com, which puts together all the wrongdoings of human beings everywhere in the world, and you will find India amongst the lowest in any crime, including murder, including dacoity. So there is something called a collective ethical behavioral ecosystem, and that exists according to me. In every society it is there. Take for instance even the kind of violence we do to animals. You know, the average meat eating in America is 180 kg per individual. It is 5 kg in India. In Pakistan, which is a Muslim society, 8 kg. In Bangladesh, which is a Muslim society, 6 kg. So there is something. 2.4% of land area India has. And we have 17% of human population and 18% of animal population. 6.5% biodiversity. Do you mean to say law achieved this? There is an ethical behavioral model which is not recognized by sociologists, political thinkers, even spiritualists, which seems to be informing, guiding the people. I think a huge amount of empirical study will be needed, otherwise we will be talking above the understanding which is needed for grasping what this society is. I have a very different view. I don't want to go more into the fact that it takes us to the study of anthropology. The modern anthropology is individualism based and it is state centric, dependent on law, court, police. It is the punishing of the deviants. But our model is different. It is preventing deviants. This is what Malinowski said. But we all went by the idea of a modern society which is contractual, which was devised by people like Mill and then taken over by great thinkers like Max Weber, who combined economics and politics and the entire modern world today, including India, its constitution, its law, its economic structure is governed by this thinking. So I think we need to have a tremendous amount of intellectual stamina to unravel all this, to find out whether there is a possibility of an ethical society, ethical family, ethical community, ethical individual. This is a much comprehensive and integrated search we have to make. And if there is anything further I can say as a result of any confusion I must have created in your mind, let me try. Thank you very much.
I must ask your forgiveness because I have nothing to present which is worth of your consideration, because I have no education or knowledge of this age. I am still living in the 7th century civilization and I proudly consider myself as a savage. The word savage I took from the so-called letter of Seattle chief to the Washington governor. He repeatedly says, I am a savage, therefore I do not understand. So similarly, I do not understand the modernity, modernization and modern civilization. Nevertheless, I have a little bit of shiksha. And by that way, I also, apart from the Indian ancient tradition, I have the opportunity to read the ideas of Mahatma Gandhi, who reinterpreted the Buddha's philosophy of nonviolence in the present context and how it can be practiced in day-to-day life. The today's subject about a compromised word, which reminded me a very friendly conversation with my senior colleagues in Patna about 5-6 years ago. There was All India Sarvodaya Conference. The senior Sarvodayas and Gandhians, some of them now already passed away, were together. And one very respected person have made a statement. He have said that in this present society, we have to survive, therefore we have to compromise many things. And then my question was, in that case, what is the compulsion to survive? If you are unable to keep your faith and principles, then what is fun to be survived? Who imposed the compulsion or necessity of surviving, although you need to compromise? So there was no appropriate question at that moment, and the debate was going on for long time, and I'm still awaiting an answer to that question. If you need to be survived in order to, you need to be compromised in order to survive, then what is the necessity, the value, and the purpose of surviving? No ethical living, in my view, is much worse than 100 times of death. So that we need to be carefully examined. The compromised world, which is not very old one, the greatest compromise were been made in the last 150 years or at most 200 years. The growth of science, and which give birth to a technology, and that technology empowered the humanity to produce the commodity which are much more than what is needed by the humanity. The production of more things than the necessity, then the humanity shall have to be converted into a consumer instead of a user. In the past, the humanity used to be user. User means to use the commodity according to their need. It is very good word in Indian language, upayog. But today we are not no more upayog. You are doing upayog. We are doing upabhog. We have become boogie. And this world is commonly used, the society of upabhogis. And in the process of compromising, there are hundreds of imbalances or reverse of priority have been taking place. They are so numerous, I cannot repeat them here in a short period of time, but I would like to draw attention to 5 great compromises which are taking place through the development of modern civilization. The first is the reversal of the priority between the body and mind. The comfort of body has been given utmost importance, and the stability and the purity of mind has been entirely neglected. That was the first one. The second is the reversal of the importance of self and the other. The balance between the self and the other have been reversed, and self is considered as much more important than the others. And the third is the individual and the society. Thus, individuals become more important, and the individual right and the community right also legally or politically considered to be individual rights are much more important, and this is being reversed. And the fourth is the right and the responsibility. In the ancient time, there is only question of responsibility, and if you are performing responsibility, then there is no question of violating right of anyone. But today, we are only talking about the right, and we completely forgotten the responsibilities. Even the so-called most undemocratic institution, UNO, they have a universal declaration of human rights, but they have nothing a word talking about human responsibility or human answerability. So this is, we all accepting this, that means we all compromising all these things. And finally, the fifth one is cooperation and competition. Human beings are considered to be social living being, social creature. And social creature can survive or can live together if there is a cooperation. And competition means one is winner and the other is loser. That means a winner and loser can never be friendly with each other, compassionate with each other. It has to be a kind of anonymity or in the opposition has to be created. So this five compromises have resulted to present before the humanity so many challenges. And among the so many challenges, I would like to draw your attention only four things. The first is unprecedented increase of violence in the many forms of violence, direct violence, indirect violence, structural violence, and violence to the nature and the response from the nature, violence to the humanity, so on and so forth. Declared, undeclared wars and terrorism, so on and so forth. Because violence has become a trait, so therefore it is no hope we can reduce the violence. Everybody talk about we must oppose the terrorism by cooperating all the nations together. But all the nations need violence and terrorism just to sustain the market of their weapon production. And the weapon production is the most profitable industry, and everybody needs to sustain. Therefore, it is just a lip service we're talking about. Then the second is the gap between haves and have-nots. The poor and the rich, the gap is ever increasing. Not only the physical gap, there is a psychological gap between the rich and the poor. Even the very well-to-do people are still feeling poverty because comparison to the much richer people. And the third is destruction of environment. We have polluted and destructed the ecosystem, and today the humanity, the basic necessity for surviving is a drinking water and a breathing air. A man can survive without food for several weeks perhaps, and man cannot survive without water more than 24 hours. and perhaps a man cannot survive without breathing for a few minutes. So the basic necessity of air, water and everything has been completely contaminated, and we have to purchase everything from the multinational companies, even the drinking water, and perhaps one day we shall have to purchase even the air to breathe. This is not much too far. And finally, the dharma, the religion, is completely disappeared from the surface of earth. And what remained is the institutions, the name of the religions. Or the religion, there are three components: the religiousness, religionosity, and religionism. Religiousness is completely disappeared. No one knows what is religion. No one preaches about the religion. There is a little bit of religionosity, that is only rituals and something like that. But religionism has taken root into the mind of the people, and therefore that religionism become a source of conflict and even violence. Today in this world, a number of violence and wars which are fighting on the name of religion. Therefore, how we shall face these challenges? Each one of challenge is capable of completely destroying the earth, planet earth. Gandhi have said a very beautiful sentence that the planet earth has potential to fulfill each one living being on this, but the whole planet earth cannot satisfy a single person's greed. So therefore now everybody is being exploited its greed through comparison and competition in order to increase the consumerism and the market. So therefore the earth is unable to satisfy anybody's greed, and this is the real situation. In such circumstances, what we shall do, that is the question. Now the ethic, of course ethic is an individual virtue, no doubt. But this individual virtue can only be cultivated or practiced in the context or in the relation with the entire sentient being. If there's no sentient being or no society or no community, then the concept of virtue or concept of ethics does not arise. Absence of no killing or incapability of no killing is not a virtue. No killing becomes virtue when you have some object which can be killed and you are refraining from doing that. That only makes a virtue. So therefore all virtues can be established or increased or practiced or cultivated in the relation with the other living beings. So therefore we shall have to think about re-establishment of the ethic if possible. That also beyond religion, because now all the religions have been completely failed to impart or to establish an ethical society, as I mentioned before. So therefore, beyond religion, can we think of an ethical way of living? And for that, I think there are basic two necessity. One is a fundamental shift or change in our education system. And the second is fundamental change in our economic system. And thirdly, if this true change is possible, then third change of the governance or the politics. That is not very difficult if the education and economic system is able to change. So, in a nutshell, can we go back to establish a system of economy which is based on non-violence, eco-friendly, sustainable, and beneficial to poorest of the poor? These four cross-cutting criteria for economy is necessary to make the economy system as ethical. Otherwise, there can never be any economy system which can be compatible with ethics and ethical system. So for that, localization and need base, these two is absolutely necessary. Economic, often a need base, and it is localized. Then at the same time, economy and political governance both must be non-centralized. Decentralization will not work. Today, everybody talk about decentralization. Decentralization means there is a centralization and then you put it as a small pieces and it's distributing to the others. Vinoba Bhabhi have said that a big storm, if you make it pieces and distribute it, still it will remain a storm. It cannot be something else. So therefore, a political system and an economic system, right from the beginning, no centralized one. And this is very much possible. And there we can go at length to explain how it is possible, particularly the Buddhist way of economy. The right livelihood, the principle of right livelihood can explain economy of need base and economy of localized. So, genuine democracy as a system of governance, that means no division between the ruler and the ruled. Unless you completely do away with the classification, some of them as called elected leader, and they are the administrators or the other rulers, and the rest of the people are being ruled. The real meaning of democracy or prajatantra or swaraj, that means a self-voluntarily organized and controlled and ethical, which has to be developed in the individual minds in relationship with the society. And the Gandhi's idea of swaraj is the real, in real sense, a genuine democracy. If these combinations are put together, then we can hope an ethical society in the future. Otherwise, the life of the planet Earth, the only place we are living and surviving, may not be remain for a long period of time. It is been faced by so many challenges, as I mentioned before. These are a few things in a nutshell. You need not to agree to this. I only mentioned this, how I look at the present situation and present state. And this is my view. And you need not to agree to that. But it is a piece of information you may consider as some people, some stupid people are thinking in this way also. It may be impossibility, but I think if you examine it through a rational mind and without any preconceptions or prejudices, and it might give some sense to everybody. Thank you very much.
Thank you both for your thoughtful remarks. I think to move the conversation forward, we have talked a lot about symptoms of what this compromised world looks like, what this compromised society looks like. And I'm not sure if the idea of nostalgia is very helpful, meaning, yes, if we had a time machine and we told ourselves that we could go back at a certain point in time where the society was more ethical, I'm not entirely sure historically we have the data to actually say that a particular century in the past was more ethical or not. But the second part is that we are at a stage where we need to make some crucial choices, some systemic changes, because we have come to recognize that we live in broken systems and there are no sort of passive bystanders to these broken systems, meaning if we don't do anything, we simply perpetuate the broken system. So there's no such thing as I will not participate in a broken system. Just by your very existing, you're participating and perpetuating a broken system. So we are in one of those phases of dilemma. The question I wanted to put forth is that if we talk about trying to implement or bring about some kind of change in terms of ethical awareness or some sort of behavioral change that is much needed in society. One of the things that I'm interested in solutions. So which is that we talk about, you know, whether we should focus on the individual in terms of transformation or change, or whether we should focus on the society, meaning that we understand the relationship between individual and ecosystem or individual and society, that both are needed to create the change, support the change, and so on. But in your thoughts, in your experience, where should we begin? Where should we begin? Meaning the idea of changing society, of changing world, sounds like a monumental challenge in some ways. Right? But at the same time, the idea of changing 7 billion human beings at a time also sounds like a monumental challenge. Where should we begin?
First of all, I don't agree that everything is lost. In fact, we are actually undermining the existing ethical, moral institutions. I'm not talking about religious institutions. Even today, 9 out of 10 boys and girls support their parents in this country. That is why the huge social security and health security obligations which fall upon the government, you don't see in India. But we are trying to undercut and undermine and destroy that institution by bringing in laws, by bringing in social theory, celebrating it. Even some of us are presiding over that and saying, this is how it should be. So, individualism, promoting individualism will destroy the ethical foundations of a society. But are we not doing it? We are actively promoting individualism, individual rights, which tower over elders, teachers, parents, then how do you build an ethical society? An ethical society requires two main pillars, which cannot be legislated. One is aparigraha, another is niraham bhavana. Humility cannot be legislated, contentment cannot be legislated. it has to be a behavioral model which is very natural. It will not come by reading Bhagavad Gita. A model of life where I see my mother, where I see my father, my elder brother, and so many people who give up their everything to bring up their children. And you have a social theory today, you have a sociology today, you have a constitution today, you have law today. He says you revolt against all these people and yet you have a right. I believe that the modern institutions need to be very, very critically examined. I am not saying everything is wrong, but something is certainly wrong. And the relationship between individual and the society which we talk of, where do we maintain the balance in our constitution? The constitution is completely individualism based. As Rinpoche ji said, the idea of duty. Now, I remember when H.G. Wells wrote an appeal to Mahatma Gandhi, asking him to support what is the today Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This was supposed to be the Intellectual Declaration of Human Rights. Mahatma Gandhi said, I will never sign a declaration which is insisting on rights. The greatest harm that modernity has caused is exclusively focusing on rights. This is adharma. Dharma begins and ends in duties, which protects everybody's rights. And there is a dialogue which even modern intellectuals and spiritualists have had during the pre-independence period, which has virtually stopped in the post-independence India. But the society has not listened to the state. It has not listened to the individuals, it has not listened to the economists, it has not listened to the political parties, and that is why we have a social order today. The social order is supposed to be social supervision, social policing. We try to deride a society's capacity to influence and regulate the conduct of the people. In modern terminology, this is seen as policing. Are we really protesting against this kind of public discourse? So, when we want to build or rebuild or recover the ethical foundation or behavioral model, are we not to look at the, in whatever state they are, the non-formal institution, a non-formal moral order which still works? And works against all odds.
So, what are some of the
my
examples?
My feeling is, first, when we talk about education, we must first try to learn from the society and we should not try to teach the society. This is what we are doing. Our universities, our media, our intellectuals, they all feel the society is wrong. I have to correct the society. But there are many good things in the society. So, I believe that what started in the colonial period as civilizing the people is now turning into modernizing the people without knowing what is modernity. Modernity means irreverence. This is the latest debate in America. You build irreverence by creating a host of rights, elders' rights, children's rights, parents' rights, animals' rights. This is a whole lot of, a plethora of rights. But the society is living the other way. So, I believe that much of what we have learned has to be unlearned. And we must begin a new way of learning. And there is much in the society, in the behavior of our, you know, I have learned so much from my mother, which I could never have learned from any university or any great scholar. That institution is, according to me, still available, but in the public discourse, it is not only absent. We call that institution an institution to be discarded. Then how do you build up the ethical foundations of a human behavior?
Any comments?
Compulsory?
change of society can never be imposed by system or by law or by any directive or order. The change of society shall have to begin from the change of individual. Your question, from where we should start? In my view, we should start by our own self, by myself, for example. If I am not changing and I am only talking the vices and the defects, and without changing myself, refraining from them, there can never be hope or even initiate any change. The initiative of change must be from the oneself. If one is changed and a little bit of moral and ethical strength is built within oneself, then he or she can be an instrumental changing his or her family members, community members, and even the larger society. The example of Buddha, the Mahavira, or the Gandhi, all of them did not started preaching right from the beginning. They go through a great deal of changing themselves, evolving themselves, and with great tapasya and enduring. And only thereafter, their voice have been heard, and they are able to bring a larger change in the society and the community. A law can never be an instrument for improving morality or ethics. I'm not a student of law, but last year I was invited by the Central University of Himachal Pradesh for an international lawyers conference. In that international lawyers conference, I was asked to preside a small section, and there was four presenters. One is from Europe, the other is from Tajikistan, the third is somewhere from Singapore, and the fourth was Indian, a senior lawyer. All the four lawyers' presentation was to argue the man-made law can never be deliver justice to anyone. And it is the capacity of the lawyer, how he can construct false statements and evidences, and by that way the law can be taken anywhere, everywhere. So therefore, not killing or not stealing due to the fear of the Indian penal code or law is not an ethical behavior. It is just keep oneself out of the police custody or not being punished by the law. And it is not an ethical, it has no value. The ethical means having consideration to others. The importance of the life of others, and therefore I will not do any harm, even a small insect's life. So that is the real ethical. It has to come from the one's own heart, and the seed of that is the understanding of equality of all sentient beings and compassionate mind to all sentient beings. That alone can build all kind of ethical and moral force. For that purpose, we shall have to, as I mentioned before, pay attention to the basic education system, and the social behavior, which maybe begin from the oneself and from the family and from the community. So if we do this in a well-planned manner, I think it is not impossible.
So one of the premises has been about what you suggested early on, that ethics is sort of in terms of correcting the deviance or avoiding the deviance. And that's sort of the common norm around ethics. Generally, when we talk about individuals being ethical, we are implying some form of restraint mechanism. But human behavior is such that the more you tell them to restrain, the more eager they are to violate that object of restraint. I mean, that's what we see generally. Can ethics have a different purview? Can it be thought of in terms of human flourishing? Can it be thought of in terms of optimization of a certain sort? Meaning, rather than just limiting the discourse of ethics in terms of restraining mechanism, are there other purviews, are there other sort of encouraging sort of ideas around ethics that we can look at in terms of framework?
The functioning of the societies today is a restrained way of functioning. This is how I recognize the society. I'll give you two examples. There was one last valid test which was conducted in about 108 countries all over the world. You throw wallets containing 20,000, 50,000 and throw it in the park, in the railway stations or whatever, and see how many are returned to the true owner, because there is a visiting card is kept there. The rate of return in India was 65%, on par with any of the developed nations. But your newspapers will never report this. Because the newspapers always report what is rare. The newspapers will report a theft. In fact, one railway board chief told me once, "Sir, we have prevented nearly 500 railway accidents. Only one we could not prevent, and that is what got reported." There was one mobile telephone test which was done in Bombay. Out of 30 telephones which were lost, 25 telephones were returned, on par with New York. See, the behavior of the people I have seen, in fact, one of the auto rickshaw drivers whom we asked him to address a school Republic Day parade, he couldn't even speak. But what was the qualification we saw in him? He found that somebody went to the railway station and he found there was a bag, and you know, about 4-5 lakhs of rupees was there. And he straight went to the commissioner's office and gave that money to the commissioner. "Sir, this fellow has left to Madurai or somewhere, and this is the money." So the next day it came in the newspapers. We all went and met him. "Sir, this is the first time I have not handed over to the owner. I have handed over telephones, I have handed over some..." Because this time the owner ran away, so I had to give it to the commissioner. We went to his house. It was a one-room apartment, and that 5 lakh rupees would have transformed his life. So we asked him to address the Republic Day parade of a school and made the students see. This is the man. We spoke about him. He didn't speak. Who are we promoting before the people? Who are we presenting? Yadithacharati sreshtaha tattateva itaro janaha sayat pramanam kurute lokastat anuvartate. You present an MLA, you present a fraud, you present a cheat, because you need him. Are you building up an ethical basis of a society? The society is ethical, otherwise this country will be totally anarchic. It requires an empirical understanding of the society. But we abuse this society. We abuse the reverential icons of the society. That is where I am again coming back to our way of perceiving things. So my way to start with will be that obviously I am not going to tell the people you are ethical unless I have some amount of ethical behavior. Of course, in Srimad Bhagavatam, about the Lakshanas of Kali Yuga, there is a verse which says, in Kali Yuga, orators will be mistaken for scholars. We have seen the effect of it in Tamil Nadu in the last 40-50 years. So, somebody talks well does not mean he is ethical. And somebody like the auto rickshaw driver who could not talk, he was ethical, ethics personified before 2500 students. So, I think there is something wrong with we who call ourselves intellectuals, elites, understanding, educated. What icons to present before the people? We are running schools. Can we stop calling the politicians to present them before the school? A simple thing. Can you call these people and tell about them? So, this is how we have to rebuild the, that we are not teaching the society. We are recognizing the ethical impulses of the society. The society, according to me, has ethical impulses quite active even today. But we think everything is lost because we believe the newspapers. I will conclude with what the newspapers do, because my friends from newspapers are also here. I also belong to a newspaper. The newspapers will never report if dogs bite human beings. And dogs always bite human beings everywhere. So, that's no news. If human beings bite dogs, then the newspapers will report. Let's assume one man bites a dog in Chennai. Man has bitten dog in Chennai. Then some other madman bites the dog in Coimbatore. Man has started biting dog even in Coimbatore, then Trichy. Then after 10 news items appear, you will get the impression dogs have stopped biting human beings. It is the other way. I know what the newspapers do. I know. That is not the society. There is a hidden society which is shy. Modernity produces a shameless society. I'll tell you, in my village, I come from a village. Unless you come from a village, you can't understand 50% of India. If somebody comes drunk, the mother will take the father, and where are you drunk, coming drinking, come on, children should not see it. The children's behavior is important for her, because she cannot correct the husband. But modernity says, no, cocktail party. Why do you feel shy? Drink openly. I am not saying drinking is wrong. I am saying that you need not have to celebrate it. Are we understanding the difference between the society and modernity? These are all fundamental questions. Unless we introspect this way, this huge consumption we are talking about, we celebrate it. We are the people celebrating it. So, we have no right to pontificate to the society. If we understand that simply because we know some language, and particularly English language, if you know, you are supposed to be the most intelligent man in the country. So, we keep pontificating, so say you should be like this, you should be like this, but please go and see them. My views are different.
We'll probably open it to the audience then. Maybe, are we using a microphone or anything, or can they just speak?
We were all talking about ethics, imagining that we know what is ethics. Can you please define ethics? Can you give a definition of ethics? But I go a step forward. My mind, I equate dharma, which is used in normal parlance, to ethics. But what is dharma? You know, each one has got its own definition or whatever. I just give two examples. Short. You want to get a certain thing done. You pay speed money. which is definitely not ethical, but it is the interest of, say, a certain organization.
You mean bribe?
Yeah, of course. I didn't
that, that's the most
the word that, bribe.
That's the most politically correct terminology I've heard.
Yeah, I know, but I deliberately didn't want to use the word bribe.
Intellectual justification of bribe.
And to another example from the Ramayana, for instance, you know, Ravana's brother Vibhishana, he went against him. But Kumbhakarna was with Ravana. Each one justified his role which he played. How do you define this? Each one. So I believe that no one can be said as to be ethical or not ethical. And how do you determine this? I mean, I'm sure everybody here, every one in this hall thinks he or she is ethical. But I don't agree with that. But I've just cited two instances. I'm sure every one of us have faced this sort of situation. Can we just say, I will not do this, I will not pay this bribe, come what may, we wouldn't do that. If it is not going to affect anybody else, then you start compromising. The moment you say compromise, the values are lost.
Rupuji, if I may follow up on that part of question, which is that should there be, or is there a sense of absolute ethics, meaning that ethics or notion of ethics that transcends society and culture, that becomes central to human, or central to the idea of, that you have raised about sentient beings, meaning are there aspects of ethics that should just be absolute, that humans should not deviate from? Yes. Because the gentleman raised the question about rationalization. And that's one of the plagues of humanity, especially people who are highly educated. We can pretty much rationalize all of our actions to our own benefit. And the more educated you are, the better you get at it in terms of using your own narratives, your own logical to rationalize a particular set of actions. But should there be some form of ethics that we don't subject to rationalization?
My way of looking to at the ethics and ethical behavior, I consider all the ethics are of absolute nature. It cannot be interpreted or leave it for me, some excuses. No unethical action can be justified through a logic or rational. Then what is your criteria to define an action is ethical and not ethical? The first I would say, whatever action or behavior which is directly or indirectly or structurally cause violence to any other sentient being is unethical. Not causing directly, indirectly or structurally any harm or any violence to any other or on the contrary it gives benefit directly or indirectly, these actions are ethical. That is a general definition. Having said that, how you decide one action is violent or non-violent, in that question, I would not say the nature of action itself can be justify itself as a violence or no violence. It always depends on the situation, the motivation, and the intention by which the act is performed. In the Jataka Kathas, when Buddha was born as a captain of ship, and he has to kill a person, a robber. And that killing was out of immense compassion for that person who is going to indulge immense violence act, no virtuous act. Due to that, that person would suffer for very, very long time. So he took the responsibility, I will do the same. I will do the no virtuous act, and I will suffer instead of let him indulge in that. So this is completely out of a compassionate act. So that is, even an act of killing is considered to be a non-violent act. So by this way, if we take the Ravan's katha, who stood with a violent person, or who stood with a just or truth side, I don't know. Rama can be considered completely a non-violent person or not, that is a different question. But who stood with the truth is virtuous or ethical. Who stood on the falsehood, that's unethical. By that way, we shall have to be defined.
Hello, sir. It's a modern social scientist. Actually, modern world is ruled by the global. Hello?
If you're using a microphone, you can lower the voice. Okay. If you don't want to use the microphone, you can heighten your voice.
Sorry. See, the global world is ruled by the corporates. See, their main ethics is to make money out of divide and rule the country. See, they only rule world and state and society, everything. See, you actually we are all talking about ethics. The olden ethics was uniting the society with ethical value. These are two things are controversial, contradictions. See, we are moving towards the modern world and we want to maintain ethics. How we are going to attain this?
If you want to repeat the question.
Yeah. See, the modern world is ruled by the corporate.
Right.
The main ethic is to make money by divide and rule policies. They are splitting the people, and their main ethics is to make money. Whatever you do, you have to make money. The whole world is moving towards that direction. See, what we are trying to say, we are going back to the ancient society, and we want to unite everyone for the common cause, for going in a peaceful way. See?
So I get the point. But the thing is that, so I'll raise the question.
My view is corporates will unite the people if that will give them money.
Yeah.
I don't say corporates will divide the people and make money. Corporate will always try to make money. But corporates are only the symptoms. There is an economic philosophy which is founded on pure contractual relationship between people. And that economic philosophy has been recognized in the last 100 years as the growth model. And every economist, and he cannot be an economist unless he subscribes to this view. If somebody thinks differently, he will be called, as I was called once, now most people do not call me like that, I was called a Neanderthal economist. So my time was frozen like that. But still there is a huge amount of rethinking that is taking place in the world, because I keep in live touch with economic issues. The world is rethinking. But unfortunately, the Indian discourse does not reflect that rethinking. Here the English educated intellectuals are the biggest block for rethinking in India, because they don't think as independent individuals. In fact, in 1947, on the 15th of August, when we got independence, two great men issued statements about what we should do in independent India. Aurobindo said this whole independence is artificial, and so we will have a united India. That was his great statement when Bangladesh was separated from Pakistan. I think Rajaji quoted this. Another great man issued a statement that we have become free, now we can become independent. Freedom is a status or the point at which a person begins to be independent. We have come out of jail, that means we can think independently. That process has not begun in India. And I would charge the English educated individuals for having stopped the process of thinking independently in India. They have never read any Indian literature. And this started with Karl Marx in 1853. Karl Marx wrote a couple of articles in New York Herald Tribune, which is the International Herald Tribune, in which he actually praised the state of the Indian economy at that time. He said that Indian economy is organized on the basis of villages and there is very little distinction between the producer and the consumer. It is some kind of a primitive socialism, but unfortunately these are semi-barbaric people worshipping cow and monkey. By that standard, even today we are semi-barbaric society. Then Max Weber, who structured the modern Western world today, he was right. All Protestant societies were growing faster. Catholic societies were lagging behind. So he said Protestant Christian ethic alone will promote modern capitalism. But he wrote two books, which is very important. Rinpocheji perhaps will devote some attention to this.
He is aware of it, Gospel of Prosperity.
No, Religion of Hinduism and Buddhism.
No, but the theme was the Gospel of Prosperity.
Yeah. In which he said two societies can never prosper because they believe in karma and rebirth. That is India and China. You know, our entire sociology department, economics department, political establishment is influenced by these two great men. We are not even aware we are being influenced by them. And we speak in their language, we assess our society. So that is why I believe that the English educated individuals beginning to introspect and rethinking about India is the first step towards correcting the education system of India. Education system of India cannot be corrected by the education or HRD minister. He is a prisoner of the public opinion that is being made by these people. So we have to begin with, at least we have to collect some 10,000 English educated intellectuals and begin discussing with them these fundamentals and whether they can hold on to the view which they are holding. That's far more important than saying the government must correct. The government is a reactive institution today. It is not a proactive institution. In only one or two decisions, Narendra Modi has shown proactivity, including this demonetization. Otherwise, it is only a reactive institution. I again go to this, that the arresting of the Indian mind by the elites of India has to be really exposed. Then only I think this process can begin. To address your thing, when I was in Japan in January, they asked me a question. How is that India such a diverse society? Enormous amount of diversity. Keep India on the one side and the rest of the world on the other, you will see more diversity in India than the rest of the world put together. How are you able to work as a democracy? I said democracy is needed only for diversity. Now, for a homogeneous society, what is the need for democracy? I said we work like this. Sita obeyed Rama, she was great. Meera defied her husband, she is also great. Rama obeyed his father, he is great. Prahlada defied his father, he is great. So we can accept a totally contradicting acts. But as Rinpocheji said, the motive of the act is more important. So if you look at the motive of the act, the manifestation of the act will not appear as something which misguides you. So this education can come only if English educated people take up the responsibility on themselves. It cannot be done by government.
Maybe we'll do one last question.
The people will get a government they deserve. And more people, representatives of criminal background are going to the parliament. This is a reflection of the society's approach. Even among the criminal records, the rigorous criminal becomes the leader. So that is the thing that we are seeing today also. Even for taking this demonetization, what is given in the currency? I promise to pay the bearer the sum of rupees. And we are justifying the demonetization in order to punish few people and making obstacles for the entire 120 crore people.
You have a question, sir?
Yeah, the question is the society, as we boast, is fairly ethical and civilized, is untrue. The society now itself is unethical and indisciplined.
I think you two need to have a conversation.
Yeah, you are boasting that our society is fairly ethical and civilized. I say it is not so.
In one sentence,
the government is an example for the election by the society.
One sentence I will try and reply. The society does not know how to deal with a dishonest polity.
Let me actually give chance to somebody who has more of their life to look forward to.
Hello. Sir, can you give us any examples of any system of economic organization that does not use property rights, as you are opposing rights for so long, that does not oppose property rights and still produces efficiency so that we can defend ourselves, as you said, against invasions? And also I wanted to ask that since you're opposed to Indian English intellectuals, like what work has the indigenous tribe done for the last 70 years? I mean, we are also waiting to see some results. I mean, if you could refer us to that, we would love to interact with it. Thank you.
Yeah. You see, when Max Weber and Karl Marx wrote about India, that it is an underperforming society, then one great economist in India by name Professor Rajkrishna, he was asked, why India is underperforming? We are following the same socialist policies like Russia and Yugoslavia and East European countries. He said, no, whatever policies you follow, you will have only Hindu rate of growth. This was picked up by McNamara, the World Bank chair president, and he addressed at least half a dozen conferences appealing for aid for India, which is structurally not capable of performing well. This was the brand of India. In 1983, the whole thing changed upside down because Paul Bayrou, a Belgian economist, was asked to study the economic performance of various nations between 1750 and 1900. And he came up with an astounding finding that in 1750, China was the leader and India was number 2 with 25% of world GDP, and America and England put together just 2%. So it created such a furor, and everything turned upside down in 1900. China and India crashed to 8%. And America and England went up to 41%. So many historians began writing, let us admit that we didn't have a higher standard of living than India and China in 1750. So they constituted through the OECD a study of world economy for 2000 years. Angus Madison, World Economic History, a Millennial Perspective. So from the first year of the Common Era to 2000, till 1700, India and China were the leaders. That is what Angus Madison concluded. In India, at that time, there was no absolute individual right to property. No, in no village, a king could not acquire property. Lawyers must be here. The principle of eminent domain, by which the king can acquire properties of people against their will, never applied in India till the Land Acquisition Act was passed. The king can do no wrong principle, which is one of the fundamental principles of English constitutional law, never applied in India. And India was a performing society. And when I mentioned all this to the IIT people, IIT fellows were not aware in Bombay. And then they asked me to regularly conduct a course. This is the fifth year I am going to run a course in IIT on the Indian economic history. So, simply because property right is not there for an individual, society cannot underperform. Only a society where property rights are centralized, like communist society, a society underperforms in economics. So, you go to Arunachal Pradesh, I have gone there. You must all go there to study. You don't study economics in metros. In Arunachal Pradesh, in a village, if there are 30 families, the lands are common, and the 30 families in routine will plant, will harvest. If somebody is married, the entire village will join together to build a house. Even now it is prevalent. So, performance or underperformance is not related to rights, duties. This is the first thing. Second thing, enormous amount of work has been done in Hindi literature, Tamil literature, various language literature. But we have stopped studying these languages first. And we are saying, what work you have done? We have stopped reading Tamil in Tamil Nadu. So, we have to really introspect where we are going wrong. Even now I am saying we are only going wrong, not that we have gone wrong. We are a highly recoverable society. We don't have 55% of first marriages ending in divorce. 67% of the second marriages ending in divorce. 74% of the third marriages ending in divorce. We don't have 51% of the families where father and mother do not live together. They are irrecoverable societies. We are not an irrecoverable society.
All right. I think we'll bring this to closure. I just want to give Rinpoche the last word.
Yeah. I wanted to say only a few words because one question, if I understood correctly, the modernity can go with the ethical behavior. My personal view is it is impossible. That's why in the very beginning I introduced myself. I'm still live in the 7th century and I'm an savage. Just wanted to say I'm not an unethical person. To describe the modernity, I will quote only my late friend, Professor A.K. Saran. Novelty, self-grounding, violence, synonym to modernity. That sums up everything. And a little further, if you read the small, unassuming book of Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, the titled Hind Swaraj. If you read the Hind Swaraj, you will understand what is modernity and what kind of thirst the modernity is offering to the humanity. So therefore, the modernity, modernization and the ethical, these are completely incompatible with each other, that we have to understand. Unless it is understood, we make effort to make the modernity ethical, I don't think it will give any result.
Correct.
Thank you.
That's the last word. Well, yeah, I forgot the ritual of concluding remarks. So in terms of concluding remarks, as you can see that there are differing opinions, a lot of generalizations. I work in an institution that prides in data, and having worked with data, I know it's not all correct. And historical data especially is suspicious in certain ways. But for me, the issue of course remains is that we are at a time when I don't think we can continue to engage in sort of a divisive sense of communities or ethics. Otherwise, we sort of, I grew up in a village and I moved out of village and I still keep going back to village. But the problem is that if every community starts to have its own sort of self-righteous ethical standards, we create a world of porcupines. you know, porcupines. And any time a threat arises, they shoot their needles out. Modernity is a representation of porcupinal mindset. We live in that mindset. For me, the challenge is not so much as to just keep describing the symptoms of what the symptoms of modernity are. We are here. For me, the challenge is, what is the role of individuals and organizations or institutions to take us out of here? There are certain challenges that are unprecedented and we cannot ignore it, whether it has to do with environmental crisis. Environmental crisis is irreversible. No matter of individual behavioral change is going to reverse the crisis that we are in. There needs to be something else that needs to be get done about it, and it's a question of which direction we want to move in. We can talk about ethics and war and so on, but given that a few months ago both United States and China have spent or committed about $18 billion each on artificial intelligence and warfare, all ethics is not going to respond to it. We'll have to look at new framework for ethics on artificial intelligence and battlefield, when humans are not fighting, but machines are, intelligent machines are, on behalf of humans, who controls it, and so on. So we will be dealing with, that's the exciting part of the world, we constantly tend to create new problems for ourselves, just to keep ourselves engaged in certain things. But I think the challenge is that we need to perhaps learn from the past, but we don't have a time machine. And even if we believe that there was a golden era, and every society has a different description of what their golden era was, or golden ages, we cannot sort of move into that era. We cannot shift into that era. So the question still remains is, what are the lessons we have learned from the past? And how do we sort of institutionalize those lessons in order to take society into future directions? We are treading very dangerous waters. I mean, if you look at recent elections in many places and so on, not that it dictates the entire world's thing, but the world is a small place. And it becomes a reflection of this porcupinal mindset. And that's why I think the idea of compassion as the basis of ethics, or compassion as the basis of morality, becomes a useful tool. We need to think beyond, I think, just religious notions of ethics and so on. And it's a work to be continued. So I think Chennai International Center has many more such dialogues to be convened, because this challenge, I think, is something that would be very immediate to us, and we have to sort of collectively try to pursue which direction we are going into. So thank you again, and thank you for coming this evening.
We all came to this event not quite knowing what to expect, but what we got have been wonderfully enriching perspectives, nuanced perspectives, which should set us thinking on the way we do business, way we live our lives, and the way we relate to other people. For this, we owe much thanks to our panelists, Shri Gurumurthy, Venerable Tenzin Priyadarshi, and Venerable Samdong Rinpoche. We also owe thanks to the Madras School of Economics, its director, Dr. Sundar Ramaswamy, and the wonderfully engaged students up there, to the media, and to all of you. I should also remind you of the event, back-to-back event tomorrow, when we have conversations with Sadhguru at Grand Chola, 6:30 tomorrow.